August 1946, the general manager of the narrow gauge Festiniog Railway Company sent this letter to the few remaining members of his staff. Dear sir, there will be no further traffic conveyed over this railway and the service of the staff is dispensed with. I therefore regret having to inform you that your services will not be required after tomorrow, the third instant. Yours faithfully, R. Evans, General Manager. And so, with 24 hours notice, 100 years of railway history came to an end. Mind you, the Festiniog Railway hadn't carried passengers since before the war, and the once prosperous slave trade had finished. Later on, they even drowned part of the line to make room for an hydroelectric scheme. No death could have appeared to be more final. But impossible, though it seemed, the Festiniog rose again from the wreckage. Today, 25 years after it was revived, it carries 400,000 passengers a year and is the most successful private railway in Britain. Festiniog has had many brushes with death, from the days when men struggled to throw this barrier across a tide-ripped estuary. It survived them all to become the oldest narrow-gauge line in the world. Since 1836, the line has joined the two old counties of Carnarvon and Merionethwith its lower terminus at the harbour of Portmarnock. The track crosses the 1,600-yard embankment called the Cob, and climbs for 12 miles up the Vale of Festiniog towards the distant slate town of Blaenau Festiniog. Even the railway's name has not been safe from attack. In Welsh, the word Festiniog begins with two letters F. But although the line takes its title from the Vale of Festiniog, because of English influence, it uses only one F on the front of its name. In an area where Welsh is still the first language, the anglicized version is not popular with the Welsh nationalists. There's also dispute about where the town of Port Maddock got its name. Was it from the legendary navigator Prince Maddock? An old Welsh story claims he sailed to discover America 300 years before Columbus. Or is it more prosaically called after the enterprising William Maddox, who came here to build the Cob and realize a dream? There would be no Festiniog Railway today without this embankment here, linking Port Maddock with the other side of the estuary and the rest of the line. Things were very different in 1800, when this area was a vast tidal arm of the sea inhabited by just a few fishermen, and the mountains reflected in the water, forming a mirror of Snowdonia. This unspoiled scene was changed forever by William Maddox, a Welsh landowner, MP for Boston in Lincolnshire, when he decided to end the isolation of this part of North Wales. What better way of doing it than by throwing a road across this enormous natural barrier, this inlet of the sea? Maddox started in a small way. He found that local farmers had tried to wrest little bits of land from the sea by building embankments at its edge. He took over a house strategically situated, looking out across the estuary, and reclaimed the land immediately below it with a small trial dam of his own. Under the cliff, which marked the old shoreline, he founded a model town, christened Tremadoc, in his own honor. This was to be a staging post on the coach route from London to departure point for Ireland. And even in today's traffic, it still breathes the confidence of the 18th century improving developer. Maddox's next step was to drain 4,000 acres of the great estuary, keeping out the sea with a mile-long barrier called the Cop. Hordes of local workmen spent 3 years quarrying and dumping enough stone to complete the embankment. As soon as they'd finished, a tremendous gale smashed a breach into the wall. Maddox's plans and the yet unbuilt Festiniog line were already in dire trouble. Riptides tore at the barrier while Maddox hovered on the edge of bankruptcy. To the rescue came the poet Percy Bysshe Shelley, one of the more unlikely characters to appear in the Festiniog story. He put himself down for a £100 subscription, worth about £5,000 today, and took a lease on the house that Maddox had built high above the Cob. From there, he helped persuade local gentry to send men and horses to reinforce the wall. After strenuous efforts, the barrier was repaired, the sea driven back, the Cob was saved. Maddox's plan had succeeded. But now events took over. Away in the hills, the local quarries were looking for a cheap way to send their slates to market. And at sea level, changes beside the Cob produced their own surprise. The river Glaslyn, dammed by the Cob, soon scoured a deep channel at one side of the embankment, which formed a sort of natural harbour. It was christened Port Maddox. Now, to men of intelligence, the conclusion became obvious. A railway to take the slates down from Blighney across Mr. Maddox's new embankment to ships waiting right here. And so, in 1836, the Festiniog Railway was born. At first, it carried freight only and had no locomotives. Trains ran down the whole way under their own weight, and the empty wagons were hauled up again by horses which had ridden down with the trains. The slates came from the grimly fascinating town of Blighney Festiniog, 12 miles away. They started their journey high in the hills. Slate is a heavy and cumbersome commodity to handle, and so to make the job easier, a totally integrated transport system had to be designed, a system that avoided handling slates, moving them from one vehicle to another. And so finished slates came from the Minaferran quarry down a rope-worked incline in the same wagons that were eventually coupled to the Festiniog Railway and reached the ships at Port Maddox. So the 2 foot separation of these rails also decided the width of the narrow gauge of the Festiniog. In some ways, the line is simply an overgrown mine railway. The vehicles then moved naturally onto the railway itself, where one good push sent them off on the carefully graded downhill run, which took them down through the Vale of Festiniog to Port Maddox and the sea. As trains got longer and heavier, the railway horses found it more difficult to haul the trucks back up to Blighney. A new threat to the line emerged, which made the Festiniog management sit up in alarm. It was a plan to build a competing line operating with steam locomotives. The Festiniog decided to fight fire with fire. In the 1860s, the Festiniog Railway Company decided to extend their range of operations. First, they introduced steam traction and then passenger haulage. But they were soon in problems. because the little engines they were using weren't quite man enough for the job. The line is steeply graded and climbing up the hill all the way to Blaenau. So they had two options, either to build larger engines, which of course they couldn't do because the tight loading gauge is the tight bridges and tunnels, or they could put two engines on the train. Well, that would have cost them two crews, and that's expensive. And so to the rescue came one Robert Fairley, an engineer who designed a double engine big enough and man enough for the job. Merthyr Emrys, built exactly 100 years ago, is a still living example of Fairley's solution to the problem. Fairley's answer included several new ideas. It produced a remarkable locomotive, which is basically two engines bolted together back to back in a push-me-pull-you sort of fashion. The twin assembly gives tremendous reserves of power, which allow a double Fairley to haul the heaviest trains on the line with ease. The great Robert Stephenson said it was impossible to use big steam engines on this narrow gauge line, but Fairley had radical ideas about steam locomotives, easily 50 years in advance of his time. The Festiniog was the first narrow gauge management to try them out. Fairley was so gratified that he gave them free use of his patent. Design broke away from the idea that wheels had to be fixed rigidly to the frame of the locomotive. Fairley mounted them on subframes which could swivel and powered them with steam supplied through flexible pipes. So the front end of the locomotive could enter a curve before the back end came off the straight. Under the boiler and cab of this loco, and that's long, it's almost as long as a passenger coach, are two bogies. Both bogies steam-driven. They're sort of power bogies. They're short wheelbase, like this, so they can take the curve of the line very easily. They're pivoted in the middle, like that, so that this loco can take any line much more gently than a fixed wheelbase locomotive. Now, this type of loco gave birth to a completely new locomotive style, the Bayer Garrett locomotive, which has a boiler, a normal boiler in the middle, with two power bogies, one each end, and that loco was used wherever there were mountains, from India to the Andes and to Africa. The Austrians were so impressed by the performance of this type of engine that they used it on their famous Zugbahn, the southern railway over the Semmering. And the Swiss used it to work over their passes before the tunnels were cut. The history goes even further. This Festiniog locomotive is the mother and father of all modern diesel or electric locos, because they use a system of power bogies, powered to all wheels, but on bogies to make them more flexible. Robert Fairley's patent, at the same time, ensured the continuing success of this little slate line. The slate boom of the late 19th century caused a railway war around the Blaenau mines. Two English main lines, the London and Northwestern, and the GWR, competed to carry slates, but the Festiniog held its own. Welsh slate was in demand for roofs all over the world. To this day, much of the work is done by hand, and the slates are still called by their traditional names. This size is a countess, 20 inches by 10. There are also princesses, duchesses, marchionesses, and ladies. A skilled man can work down, if needed, to less than a 32nd of an inch thick. Minute microcrystals in perfect alignment inside the stone allow it to split into these even sheets. For 40 years, dressed slates were shipped all over the world from Port Maddock Harbour. There were so many slate ships that this island, Kai Ballast, was created entirely from ballast stones. They were discharged by boats returning to collect fresh cargoes from the Festiniog wharves. But the ever-threatened railway line now faced an increasing series of problems. In the early 1900s, a great three-year strike in the quarries badly damaged trade. Railwaymen working on the Festiniog were laid off, but the line continued working. The First World War crippled slate production. The Festiniog limped on with an unexpected government subsidy. The worst blow to the line's hopes was a disastrous marriage with another narrow gauge railway nearby. It bled the Festiniog white. By 1920, Port Maddock Harbour was dead, the quays were empty, and the railway lingered on carrying tourists. In 1946, it too gave up the ghost. From Blarney to Port Maddock, the wagons ground to a halt. Weeds grew on the track, and rolling stock rotted where it stood. But this was not to be the finale. Railway enthusiasts, emboldened by the success of the Tallaght Railway, another little slate line not very far from here, decided to tackle this much more heavily engineered line. They found it a formidable task. Ready? Before the first passenger train could leave Port Maddock, the legal situation had to be sorted out. There was no easy way ahead. The railway still existed because it had been founded by an Act of Parliament, and apparently only another Act of Parliament could close it. There was no money to keep it open and no legal way to shut it down. Eventually, in 1954, with the backing of a wealthy enthusiast, the people who believed that the Festiniog could live again gained control of the company. The new railway staff were a mixed bag. Engineers, students, professional people, plus the odd real railwayman. That task looked pretty hopeless. East of the Cobb, trees as thick as a man's thigh crowded the track. Station buildings and workmen's cottages were crumbling to ruins, and local people had extended their gardens across the line. At the end of the Cobb itself, the Boston Lodge Engineering Works, named after Maddox's parliamentary constituency, was in total decay. This little engine, Welsh Pony, built by George England in 1863, had brambles growing out of its smoke box. Only belief in their own abilities kept the staff going. One of them is now general manager of the Festiniog Company, Alan Garraway.
Our first job was to try to get something happening in the workshops, and we got the simplex tractor working after about 2 days of work, a little bit of al fresco repairs in some state, but we got it working. And I can remember that first day very vividly. We came out of the works here with it, and we said, we'll go over to Port Maddock for a drink and to have our lunch. We opened those works gates down there, and then we said, no, we can't. We then spent the whole of the afternoon digging our way through a foot of sand.
It took 15 years to rebuild the line, but everything was transformed. Life and colour return to the Festiniog, especially to Boston Lodge. It's now remarkable engineering works. In the erecting shop, Prince is fast approaching completion. Prince started work on the Festiniog in 1863, and when it's fully restored to health, it'll be the oldest locomotive in the world, still operating on its original line. But Boston Lodge does more than reconstruct old engines. One of the secrets of the Festiniog's survival and success is the Lodge's original thinking. It designs and constructs its own new rolling stock, including carriages. This is a standard modern Festiniog railway carriage, and modern it is in every concept. Corridor connections, wide windows. They're using standard BR sliding windows, and they're making the whole structure, the ribs and the panels here in the shops. The ribs are square section steel and the panels are welded in. The reason for this is very simple. They don't want a long section for the panels because otherwise they tend to ripple and they show up, whereas these don't show this. On the other hand, this sort of section matches in with the rest of their carriages, the older ones, and they don't look out of place. But they have another problem, and that is the narrow gauge and the wide carriages. Because on their gauge, the carriages tend to sway a lot. And so they built and designed this bogie to fit under every one of their carriages. When they designed these bogies, they found that the swaying had to be compensated. And they looked in the automotive industry and picked up this, an ordinary standard shock absorber, which they mounted, and they're the first railway in this country to use them. And this is the Earl of Merioneth, a magnificent double Fairlie locomotive. She was built here at Boston Lodge Works and entered service earlier this year. But look what the 20th century has done for her. Total instrumentation, electric lights, quartz clock, and even a radar speed recorder. Everything that's needed to run a heavily graded and heavily operated modern line. The other locomotives on the line look as if they've always been here. But Boston Lodge has rebuilt them all. Blanche was originally designed for short trips at the Penryn slate quarries. Now she has an extra front bogie and a new fuel tender and water tanks, which allow her to make much longer hauls on the Festiniog. Mountaineer started life behind the trenches during the First World War. A giant by Festiniog standards, its cab had to be trimmed before it could go through the tunnels. And Boston Lodge is producing a standard boiler which is so good that a foreign railway is buying the design. All this is very expensive work. How can the company afford it?
BR is subsidized unwillingly by the taxpayer. We are subsidized willingly by volunteers. They provide a third of our workforce. And at present day wages rates, that is worth to us of a subsidy of about £150,000 a year. And if you add that into our finances, of course it makes things look very different. People today don't like travelling by bus. I don't know why, but they just don't. Well, perhaps I do know why. But they prefer to travel by train. And after all said and done, when you're in beautiful country, a large amount of the people that are travelling are people on holiday.
Tourism is another strand in the Festiniog's success. It's a long way from the big cities, but it can offer the attraction of its trains and its scenery, as well as the amazing Italianate village of Port Marion, on the coast, not far from Boston Lodge. Clough Williams Ellis was an endearing and sensible architect. He built Port Marion Village over a period of 50 years. And like a real village, it took 50 years to establish itself organically. He called it a haven for fallen buildings, because most of the buildings here were rescued from the breaker's yard. It's a sort of folly in a grand scale, partly to satisfy his own sense of the aesthetic, and partly to show with an impish humour that architecture could be fun. What's clever about it is that he let the buildings he finished as holiday homes to carry on paying for developing the village further. As you walk around, you don't know what it is that gives you an impression of depth and size until you discover that the whole of Port Marion is built like a theatrical set. Look at a vista from one end and it seems straightforward. Look at it from the other, and the seeing eye realizes that the perspective is cheated to make the view seem endless. Visitors accustomed to the solidity of the railway discover that windows are painted on walls, and beams, which appear to be end rafters on a sloping roof, are stage devices, concealing a flat roof which cannot be seen from below. This building looks like a town hall or a manorial building, full scale, and indeed it is. But look at this. The ground floor has been sawn off to create an effect, because look how easy it is for me to touch the top of the arch here. The whole of the Vale of Port Marion is like this. It's designed to stimulate your mind and allow you to dream during broad daylight. Willpower built Port Marion, and willpower was the ingredient needed to keep the Festiniog pushing forward uphill. Herculean efforts got it working again to the central station at Tunny Bulch, and from then on there were real problems. No roads connect with the upper parts of the line. It was a one-way ride to nowhere. Nowhere being the point 10 miles along where the rails came to a dead stop, in the waters of Llyn Ystrydau. Until recently, there was no lake here at all. To find out what happened, we have to go back to 1836. As it was intended to run as a gravity line all the way from Blaenau down to Port Madoc, the railway was built on a downhill gradient, rather like a pipeline is inclined, so that the water runs out at the bottom. The line ran along what is now the lake bed to the foothills of the Merlwyn Range, a major obstacle. So they hooked the slate trucks to a rope, which pulled them way up this incline and lowered them down the other side. The rope was wound by a water wheel, and river water released through this dam turned the wheel. But the incline slowed things down, so the next step was to bore a 700-yard tunnel to let the trains run straight through the hill. Well, that tunnel was all right as long as they used horses dragging the vehicles through. But once they introduced steam engines, of course, they were in trouble, because the engines fitted the tunnel like a cork into a bottle. And if the train ever stopped, the engines were hard pushed to get even past the boiler. And the passengers, who were mainly quarrymen at that time, did not enjoy the sulphurous fumes and smoke coming into the carriage window. The far end of the tunnel was filled in and the railway track torn up as late as 1958, when the electricity authorities decided to build a hydroelectric power station nearby. They created an artificial storage lake, Clinistradi, which seemed to block forever any chance of trains running through to Blaenau Festiniog. The lake extended half a mile between the tunnel and Blaenau and drowned the line. The new management of the railway then fought the electricity generating board in one of the longest legal battles in history, and they won, and they won compensation. In theory, they could now rebuild the line. But how? The new alignment would have to gain an extra 34 feet in height to get over the barrier of the foothills and stay above the lake. That doesn't sound much, but on an already climbing line with heavy loads being pulled, it was a formidable problem. It didn't seem possible that trains could ever enter this section of the line again. But now they're doing just that.
Train number 7 at the app. Right, thank you.
The solution was brilliant, elegant, and simple. Gain the height in the station below the lake. A climbing spiral takes the line in a 360-degree loop, which gains all the altitude required with very little waste of land. Nearly all the work to build this diverted part of the line was done by volunteers. A phenomenal amount of labor by the group which called itself the Deviationists. This is the only complete loop of a railway line anywhere in Britain. At the summit, the line levels out on its way to a new tunnel cut well above the lake level. The recipe for success over the last 25 years has been a cocktail made of engineering achievements like the deviation, riding triumphantly above the old track, of accurate recognition of the line's tourist potential, and sheer professionalism from the staff. No one on the Festiniog is just playing trains. Alan Garraway.
We are running one of the busiest railways on a single line anywhere in the world. We're running practically to maximum capacity. And we have therefore got to run it extremely efficiently. We have connections to make with BR. If our 3 o'clock train in the afternoon runs late, we delay the BR train from Blaenau Festiniog. That in turn delays the Holyhead London train, which means that trains are going to be late running into Euston. We'll be right back.
The final stage of the journey is still a bus connection to a British Rail station, but the targets in Blaenau itself are now only a mile and a half away. A footpath-like cutting is waiting to carry one track to the slate mines, which created the need for the original line. But it will now carry walking freight, tourists. And at the end of the second branch, passengers will be able to get out of the Festiniog's narrow gauge trains and transfer immediately to British Rail. The new station will be in the center of Blaenau Festiniog, built on the ruins of the Great Western Terminus. Two old enemies, the Festiniog and the GWR, will be working together at last. The attraction of the idea is obvious. The Blaenau quarries are still operational, and they represent a major tourist attraction. If petrol prices rise even further, the Festiniog line will have assured itself a rail link into this most beautiful and inaccessible part of Britain. It's a unique line, both in its concept and its engineering. Somehow, be it by magic, by hard work, whatever you may call it, the Festiniog Railway has been able to combine the charm of the world's first narrow gauge railway together with a hard-nosed professionalism that many a mainline might envy. It'll be a great day when the first narrow gauge train returns on this, its old formation, and re-enters the town of Blaenau Festiniog.